Let's look at the 3COM NBX100. Let's take a look at the system. This is the 3COM NBX100 chassis. In this case, the station cables are plugged directly into the optional hub card, which makes the system easy to install and use for a small business. On a larger system, a regular Cat5 patch cord would connect the call processor to a hub or a switch, which would also feed all of the workstation cables. Multiple chassis will support up to 200 devices. Devices can consist of IP multi-button phones, single-line phones, POTS lines with caller ID, and T1s or T1s with primary rate ISDN lines. DID, or direct inward dialing, is supported from T1s, as is ANI, or automatic number identification, which is like caller ID for T1s. The system is a built-in automated attendant and voicemail system. Because the NBX100 communicates with the phones using IP protocol, phones can be located anywhere you can get a reliable data connection. You can even put the phones anywhere on the internet, but with reduced quality. One or more optional hub cards can be put in the chassis, and the station cables plug directly into the system. The 3COM NBX100 handles branch offices connected by IP. Put chassis in more than one location and tie the systems together with a dedicated T1 or ISDN line, similar to a tie line on a conventional phone system. A CDR, or call detail recording application, is included, which allows the customer to keep track of calls made and received from each extension. The system is administered or programmed through a browser from a PC anywhere on the network or even on the internet. Here are the 3COM NBX phones. They're available in charcoal or white. They've got lots of soft buttons. And they also have a really neat feature. The 3COM NBX multi-button sets are available with an infrared port that allows you to dial the phone from the address book in a palm. So you basically just hold this in front, click dial, and it dials. Phones can be set up as a PBX with access or loop keys, or as a key system with lines programmed on dedicated keys on one or more phones, usually called a hybrid system. The extension number and programming follow the phone no matter which new or existing network jack you plug it into. Using the MAC or IP addresses, the system allows an extension to retain all of its programming, speed dials, and customized keys whenever and wherever it's plugged into the network. As we'll see later, a built-in hub or switch lets you plug a PC or laptop into a jack on the back of the phone, and it's immediately connected to the network. Phantom or virtual extensions allow remote workers to have voicemail boxes on the system. A DSS lets you create an attendant console with BLF DSS buttons for up to 100 extensions. Complement attendant software, or CAS, is included, which lets the operator or attendant or even a user look up names on the directory and transfer calls using a PC screen. A PC-based phone, PCX set, is available, which lets users make and receive calls from his PC using a standard PC headset. Hunt groups are available for incoming calls, and a user has the option of programming a button on the phone to log in and out of the hunt group so their phone won't ring while they're away. Linear and circular hunting allows the system to be used like a baby ACD or automatic call distributor. And this is neat. A user can use a regular web browser to configure and maintain the soft keys, speed dials, and the type of ringing on their own phone. New designation strips, or DESIs, can be printed for a phone right from that web browser, either for their own phone by a user or for 8 phones at a time by the system administrator or the installer. An ATA, analog terminal adapter, is available, either as a 4-port card that plugs into the chassis or a single port ATA connected to an Ethernet jack anywhere on the network. ATAs let you use faxes, modems, or any kind of analog single line device on the system. Let's take a look at some of the buttons on the phone to see how they work. First of all, we've got 12 soft keys over here. These are programmable. Some of them can be programmed by the user or by the administrator. These soft keys have lights with them, so they can be used for CO lines or busy lamps or DSS buttons for other extensions. Here's six more soft keys, but these soft keys don't have a light, so they're more like a button for, like this one is pre-programmed as the release button, flash button, call park, direct mail transfer, and a feature code button. These are very useful, and the user can also has an opportunity to program some of these themselves. We have a hold button down here, a transfer button, conference button, last number redial button, the speaker on-off button, and there's a volume control. The volume control, depending upon what state you're in, controls either the sound of the handset or the speakerphone or the ringing. There's a mute button. The mute mutes either if you're on the handset or on the speakerphone. It'll cut off the transmitter on either one. Hands-free button. This actually means that you can receive a hands-free intercom call without this button being lit. It'll be ringing. There's a message button. It's kind of blue or purple. When you push that, it'll go right to your voicemail, and this indicates that we do have a message waiting. As you can see in the screen, there's actually two messages waiting, and they're both new messages. This button's kind of neat. It's a forward mail button. When this is pushed, calls will automatically, it'll actually ring one time on your telephone and then go to voicemail. So you can turn that on and off as you need to, kind of like a do not disturb button. Program button allows you to program some of the features on the phone. And there's a two-line display at the top. These are the scroll buttons, so you can scroll between different people that you want to call on the intercom. And then these buttons down here are basically soft keys. If we wait a second, turns into select, back, or exit. So if we wanted to call Ed Evans, we'd push that button. But it actually tells us that that's this phone, Ed Evans, is extension 100. Let's start by making an intercom call. This is extension 100, and this is extension 101. We'll call on the speaker, just hit the speaker button, and dial 101. It shows on the display that we're dialing 101 Mike Smith, and on 101 we can see that Ed Evans, extension 100, is actually calling us. Hello? Oh, okay. You know, all IP phone systems have a slight delay, which can be heard if you call a nearby extension on the speakerphone. You don't hear it in a normal conversation, but that's normal for any IP telephone system. We can do the same thing by using the directory here and dialing Mike Smith, select, and that rings this phone. As you can see, it's actually coming in on one of the loop keys or the system access keys. And when we answer it, you can actually see that that key lights up steady. Since we made the call on this phone, this loop button lit up, and we can actually put that call on hold. So we can put it on hold on this phone. It's blinking here. On the white phone, we can actually put it on hold too. So now we're basically both on hold. Both of us are in hold. To go back to the call, just hit that loop button. To take it off of hold on this phone, just push the loop button, and we're back connected on the intercom. We can put it back on hold and hit another loop button, and we get new dial tone. We can dial another extension. Dial 102,
you have reached the mailbox,
and that's somebody's voicemail. If we're on a call, we'll take this off hook, and from this phone we'll go on the speaker, dial 101. It's only going to ring once on the other phone, and we can actually see on the display it says on another call, extension 101, Mike Smith. From this phone, we can put our original call on hold and go ahead and hit the second access key when we'd be all connected. I actually like using the speaker. We'll hit the hands-free key. This allows a hands-free intercom call to this phone instead of having it ring. And we'll hit speaker. Actually, I'll take the handset off and dial 101 so we don't get feedback. And we can talk to the phone. We can still see that it's from Ed Evans. It's on a loop key. I can hit the mute button on my phone, and that's going to cut it in and out. And if I actually hit the mute button on here, I would not be able to hear the person on the white phone talking back to me. We'll put that intercom call on hold, and we'll make another intercom call to the same extension. The system will let us do that. But instead of actually having a speaker call, because this phone is busy, it rings once. It allows us to put the original call on hold and then go back to the second access key. Now, this white phone is already on hold. It's busy with somebody. We'll go ahead and put it back to that original call. From this phone, we're going to go ahead and dial it again. It's going to ring once, but at this point, maybe we don't actually want to see the call. We know it's coming from Ed Evans. We're going to send him to voicemail.
You have reached the mailbox for extension 101.
That's pretty handy. And that works whether the person's on the phone or it's a new call. Just hit that key and the call is gone. As you can see, the button is lit up now, forward mail, which means from this phone, if I call 101, it'll ring once on that phone and then go to voicemail, even if he's not busy.
You have reached the mailbox for extension 101.
And this is a neat feature. If you use the directory, right now we only have three names in the directory here, but if you had a lot of names, you'd have to scroll through the whole thing by hitting these buttons. So if we wanted to go to Ed Evans, instead of doing that, you just hit E or the three twice. And since there's only one entry, you just have to hit it once. If we want to go to Mike Smith, you just hit the M and it goes to Mike Smith, or hit the S and it goes there. Hit H, it goes to Donna Hunter. Neat. Let's make some outside calls. To make an outbound call on this system, you'd normally dial 9. So you can either hit the speaker and dial 9, and then the phone number, 1-630-980-7710, and it'll ring in. We'll just go ahead and hang up. The handset would be the same, 9-980-7710 without the area code. If you want to put it on speaker when you have the handset up, just push speaker and hang up. Now you'll see it says all ports busy because all the outside lines are busy right now. That means there's no lines available. We just need to try it again. So I imagine if we try it again, it should go through. Yep. The last number redial, you just hit the redial button. It picks the line for you and dials out. Turn the volume up a little bit here.
Good afternoon. If you know the extension,
don't put the call on hold. Just push the hold button. Turn the volume down a little bit. And it'll flash on that phone. Now, as you can see on the white phone, it's not flashing there because this is not a key system. It's a PBX, and it's only on this phone. This call is being held here. But you can transfer the call, and to do that, we'll go back on the line, and we're going to hit transfer, and we're going to do what's called a supervised transfer to extension 101. A supervised transfer means we're going to let him know that he has a call. Hello? Oh, I have a call? Okay, I'll take it. And at that point, we're going to hit the transfer button one more time, and the call is off our phone, and it's on the white phone. So that's what happens if the guy wants to take the call. Let's make another call. And we're going to transfer it to 101. And we'll go ahead and answer it here. Hello? No, I don't want to talk to him. He's going to actually hang up. That leaves the call on hold on our phone because the system knew that we didn't want to transfer the call. So we can then tell the customer, I'm sorry, he's not there. Can I take a message or whatever? Okay, let's do a blind transfer. Or it's also called an unsupervised transfer where we basically transfer the call, hang up, get rid of the call. Some systems, if it's programmed that way, it'll ring back to you, but let's see. By the way, we're going to dial 101, Mike Smith. This system has a neat feature where it'll actually do redial for stations. I think that's pretty neat. Okay, another outside call. Oops, forgot to dial 9. You got to dial 9 when you're making an outside call. All right, and let's transfer that to 101. And on this system, you push transfer again, and that gets rid of the call. And it's just ringing on this phone. So we can answer it here, either on the speakerphone or on the handset. Yeah, we're going to do the same thing again, 9-980-7710. Don't forget to dial 9 when you're to make an outside call. And we'll transfer it again, but this time he's not going to answer it. We'll see if it comes back to us. 101, and we hit transfer just to dump the call on him. A blind transfer, and we can see it's ringing over here. And in a moment, it should ring back to us on this black phone. And the call's coming back to us. You can see it's on that loop key, and we can actually see that it's from Acme Computer, was the call that it's from, and we can talk to the person and say, geez, I'm sorry, he never answered. Well, this system works a little bit differently than a standard PBX in that you have to hit this transfer button to actually get rid of the call. On a standard PBX, you usually just hang the handset up, the call is gone. So you got to remember that when using this phone, that the transfer button is actually the release or the hang-up button. It doesn't work by just hanging it up. Speaking of hanging stuff up, the release button is the last button in the row of buttons without the lights. And the release button will work either from the speaker or from the handset. You can see the light is on. We'll release that. It's really made for use with a headset. So with a headset, you have to leave the handset off the hook. You'd plug your headset in, headset amplifier in there. You'd make your phone call, and when you're done, you hit release until you get the next phone call in. Let's take a look and see what it looks like to get an incoming call. We're going to make a call, and we'll go ahead and transfer that to 100. And we can see the incoming call over here is coming in on a loop key. Same button we're going to use for outgoing calls. We can go ahead and answer it. Oop, a little feedback there. And we can put it on hold. And we can make another call going out if we want. Or we can receive another call on another loop key. So let's see how that looks. Actually, we'll put this on hold. As you can see on this phone, there's already two calls on hold. But we can still make one more call with this additional system access key. And we actually, you can do it with an intercom call. So we'll just dial 100. And we can see that the second call is coming in on the second loop key. So the system access keys are both for intercom calls and for outside calls for both incoming and outgoing. So you can even see we're receiving another call now. So there's a lot of calls going on. But the loop keys give you some flexibility for making inbound and outbound calls as much as you want. Since this particular model, 3COM NBX system, can grow to a total of 200 ports, it's usually used as a PBX or a hybrid system. We've seen it as a PBX. A hybrid system would mean that there are some lines programmed like on a key system that would appear on all the phones. But you can have this system operate as strictly a key system, let's say in a small restaurant or something, with three phone lines. You'd have those three lines would be on all the keys. I did program one button on the phones. Let's go ahead and push it. This is for the door box. And in a second, it'll actually connect to the door box, and you can actually hear my voice come through the door box a little bit. I'll take it off hook there. But we can see that it's also lit up on this phone. So this particular port for the door box is appearing on both phones. If I hang up on this phone, you should see it hang up on the other phone also. I've got our door box here, so we're going to go ahead and make an incoming call also. We're going to push the button on the door box. We can see that it's coming in on the black phone. It's coming in on the white phone. I can answer it on the white phone, and you can probably hear my voice come through it a little bit. And we're going to put the call on hold. So it's on hold. It's flashing on this phone, and it's also flashing on that phone. Now that it's on hold, we can answer it over here, and you probably hear my voice coming through a little bit through this door box. By having both the dedicated button on the phone and the dial 9 access with loop keys, we've created basically a hybrid phone system. One thing about this system is that you can map CO lines, ordinary POTS lines, onto the buttons, but you can't map them if they're coming off of a T1. This system will handle T1s or T1s with primary rate ISDN on them. That'll either be 23 or 24 phone lines each. Those cannot be mapped onto here. Just standard analog phone lines can get mapped onto here. You know, if you know somebody's not at their phone, you don't want to transfer a call to their phone, have it ring four times, and then have it go to voicemail. This system makes it really easy to transfer a call directly to the person's voicemail box by hitting the direct mail transfer key. So we'll go ahead and make a call. And we're telling the customer, geez, I'm sorry he's not there. But if we hit the direct mail transfer key, we're going to send him right into this guy's mailbox. And it's extension 101. So it says enter voicemail box number 101. And it's immediately transferred into the voicemail and it's off your phone. Let's see what it takes to make a conference call. Oh, we got a call coming in. Oh, and it's from mother-in-law. Well, I guess I'll answer it. Hello, mother-in-law. How are you doing there?
Hello, Sonny.
Oh, good. I suppose you want to talk to your daughter, who's on extension 101. So we're going to conference you with 101. So we're going to hit the conference button, 101. Hello? Oh, conference with my daughter. Isn't that wonderful? Okay, so in order to put him in the, or her in the conference, we have to push the conference button. And now we're all conferenced together. Are you still there, mother-in-law?
Hello.
Oh, yeah, that's working really well. But there is another neat thing that we can do, and that's we can drop the daughter off. And to do that, we're going to hit feature code 431. And that drops the daughter off of the call. And we should still have the mother-in-law. Mother-in-law, are you still there? Oh, that works very well. You know, we don't have to use that feature code. Once we learn how to program the buttons on the phones, we can actually put one of the buttons on for conference drop, and that's a lot easier than hitting that feature code. By the way, this system can have a four-port conference or a four-party conference, so either any combination of four inside and outside people can be on it. And here's another neat feature. We've got the conference here. We can see it says conference up there. We can actually put this on hold. We put it on hold, the parties of the conference can talk between themselves, but they don't hear the music on hold, which is kind of neat. We come back, it has us on the conference also. We can do the same thing by hitting the mute button. If we're on the speakerphone or even on the handset, it'll cut that out. Another neat feature is we can take this conference and actually transfer it to another phone by just hitting transfer and 101 transfer, and it's off to another phone. Let's take a look and see what it takes to retrieve our voicemail messages. It's really easy on these phones. You push the message button, that's the blue or purple button right there. And you can see it's lit up right now. We have 15 new messages according to the display.
Take a moment to set up your mailbox.
Yeah, this is really, really easy. I'll go ahead and stop that for a second. The system actually lets you, walks you through how to set up your voicemail, and that's very neat. So for the first time, you just push this blue button.
Please take a moment to set up your mailbox. The first step in setting up your mailbox is to choose a personal password which only you know. Please choose a 4 to 10 digit password. When you are finished, press pound.
I put in 1, 2, 3, 4 like everybody else. You're not supposed to do that, though.
You have entered 1, 2, 3, 4. To keep this password, press 1. The next step in setting up your mailbox is to record your name announcement. Please state your name after the tone. When you are finished, press pound.
Mike Smith.
You recorded.
Mike Smith.
To keep this recording, press 1. The last step in setting up your mailbox is to record a personal greeting. Please record your personal greeting after the tone. When you have finished, press pound.
Hi, this is Mike Smith. I'm not in, but leave a message.
You recorded.
Hi, this is Mike Smith. I'm not in, but leave a message.
To keep this recording, press 1. Your account is active and ready to receive messages.
Of course, you don't want to use a speakerphone to set up your voicemail, but we got to hear it and it sounds fine. That was really easy to set it up. And to retrieve your messages is just as easy. Just hit the message button. And
Mike Smith.
Please enter your password followed by the pound key. 15. New messages. Main menu. To listen to your messages, press 1.
So that's all we need to do is just go through our messages. Now we can also retrieve that from another phone. We'll do it from this phone.
Extension 100.
You hit the star key.
Enter your mailbox number.
And that's 101.
Mike Smith.
Please enter your password. 15 new messages. Main menu.
So we can see that we can get it from any phone. It's very easy to retrieve your messages, and you can do that from outside also by calling into the automated attendant. Let's call in. And when it answers, we're going to enter star star.
Good afternoon. If you know the extension of the part, please enter your mailbox number.
101.
Mike Smith.
Please enter your password followed by the 16 new messages.
Okay. We got 16 new messages. We can find out from outside, from anywhere. This voicemail system has another feature that'll let you actually... It'll call you on your cell phone or your pager when you have a new message. Otherwise, it has very similar features to all the other voicemail systems out there. Let's take a look at what it takes for the user to program their own phone. And there's a lot of things the user can do. It all takes a 10 base T connection. We've got our laptop set up here. You can plug a laptop or a desktop directly into the back of the phones. And we can see down here we've got a connection. This is our 10 base T cable that actually drives the phone, but that's connected to our hub. And then there's another hub built into the phone so we can put the workstation right there. And we'll go ahead and plug that in. Okay. And we've got our telephone connected to our laptop. All we need to do now is see if we can get on the internet. And I'm going to go ahead and click on refresh. As you can see, we were not able to connect to the internet before we plugged it in. We'll see if we get our homepage. Okay, it worked, and we're on the network. We're on the same network as the NBX100, so we can bring up a browser and do user programming, and we'll actually see later we can do system programming the same way. And since we've already got a browser open, we're just going to go ahead and type the IP address of the call processor. .1.190. Okay, so we're actually connected to the call processor now through the phone, through the network, and to the call processor or the chassis. And we have a choice now of programming, logging on as the administrator, which would let us administrate the whole system if we have the password, or just the user. And to get the user in there, the username is just the extension number. So we'll start with extension 100, and the password is the same password as you had on your voicemail, which would be 1234, in our case. That's what we put in here. And you're probably better off not putting this on your password list. And that gives us all of our information right away. And we'll take a little tour of what you can do here. First of all, it has a call permissions box. This basically tells you what the system administrator has enabled the person to do with their phone. The system keeps track of the time, open, closed, lunch, and other. So in this screen, you can see when internal, local, long-distance calls, and etc. can be made. Obviously, this user cannot make long-distance calls except... when the system is open. They can make toll-free calls all the time. So this is pretty handy. They can see for themselves why they can't make a particular call. Call forwarding, it gives them an opportunity to call forward calls either to voicemail, which is the default, or to a particular automated attendant menu. You could go to, let's say, a sales menu or something like that if you're not going to be in, or to a phone number. And it could be an actual extension number, or it could be an outside number. Let's put an extension number in here first, and we'll put in 101. So whenever somebody dials extension 100, it's going to go to 101. And then we'll put in for two number of rings and apply. And this takes effect immediately. So if we take a look at the black phone, I'll dial from the white phone 100. After two rings, it should go back to 101. And there it went. You can make it go to an external number, 9. You got to dial 9 first, and then 980-7710, which means that all the calls, with two rings or three rings or whatever, are going to be forwarded externally out of the system to this phone number. So if that was my house or my car or whatever, I could actually get calls forwarded out. And this is would depend on permissions, again, of the administrator. And we'll put this back to voicemail and four rings apply. So it's kind of neat that you can actually, we'll cancel this. You can actually see the stuff take effect on the phone right away as soon as you change it. Let's take a look at hunt groups. We're already, the administrator has put us in the sales hunt group, and we're actually logged into it. We'll see how to log in and log out using the buttons on the phones in a couple of minutes here. We've looked at hunt groups, call pickup. Right now, extension 100 is not part of the default call pickup group, which is group 0. Click add to make it part of the default group. Okay, group 0 now has extension 100 and 101 in it. 101 was already in it. That was pretty easy. And this is stuff that if the user is already fairly aware of Windows stuff, they're probably going to be able to make these changes. It's a lot easier than trying to use cryptic buttons on the phones. Like on this phone, it has a program button, but it doesn't do anything on this version of the software because it's so easy to do it through the browser interface. That program button does allow you to set up an IP address. If you're taking the phone off remotely and you're going to use it from your house through the internet or through a dedicated ISDN line, you can use it to put in the IP address, and you can use it for doing some diagnostics on the phone, but it's not needed because this is so easy. This last tab here is for the quick reference sheet, and you click on it, it brings up Adobe Acrobat, and this is just a PDF file for the NBX Business Telephone Quick Reference Guide. And this is all the customer needs to have. They don't need the book, really. You can give them a book, copy of the sheet, but it's not needed. They can get it anytime they want through their browser. We all know that customers as a whole lose their books. It's buried in their drawer somewhere, and they end up calling us to answer silly questions. Anyway, this should solve a lot of that. Let's take a look at some of the other tabs. The other tabs that we have, this is all under user information. We have speed dials. These are a little small to read. APX messaging, ringer tones, and directory. To take a look at speed dials. And this has one-touch speed dials, personal, system-wide, directed pickup. And then it actually allows you to print out the DESIs for the phone. If you have an attendant console or a DSS associated with it, you can even print out those labels from here. We'll take a look at the one-touch. It gives us a picture of the phone, and this is what the system administrator has already put on our telephone. These are the loop keys, or system access keys that we saw. We have a pickup extension button, hunt group login, log out, account code button so we can enter account codes for the CDR application, and a conference drop button. We'll talk about that a little bit later. We saw how to use it as a feature button. We've got the line appearance on there. This is the door box. And let's see, down here we've also got one speed dial number put in here for Mike Sandman Enterprises. Let's put another speed dial in here. These are user speed dial numbers, so we can put in there whatever we want. 9980-7710. And in this one we'll put 101, I guess. And we hit apply. And it's already taken. We'll take a look at the phone, and that's the second one down from the top. Let's see if it dials it. Okay. That worked. And when we push this one, we get Mike Smith's phone. And again, these buttons here are without lights. These buttons here are with lights. Well, that's this personal or one-touch speed dials. Personal speed dials, you have, I think it's 98 numbers from 601 through 99 or so. So we can put whatever speed dial numbers. This is a whole lot easier than programming and stuff ourselves. 916309807710. You don't put dashes and stuff in there, and that's Mike Sandman. And this is, boy, it's just sure a lot easier than using cryptic buttons. And apply. Okay, so we'll be able to use that in a little while. We'll try that and close that down. And there are system-wide speed dials. This is handled by the administrator, but we can see what the system-wide speed dials are, so the administrator actually doesn't have to give us the list. We can actually look on it at any one time. So Mike Sandman Enterprises is speed dial number 700, and then our own personal speed dials are extensions 601 through 699. There's 100 system speed dials also. And this is directed pickup. It lets you basically assign a pickup for one particular extension to basically a button on your phone. By the way, if you need help on any of these things, you basically just click the help button and it brings up the help for that particular item. So the user has, besides the actual user's guide and the short version, the quick reference guide, the user has access to help for each individual item in the programming area here for his own phone. Telephone labels is really neat. It brings up a PDF file that lets you fill in the blanks and actually make new DESIs for your own phone. To do that, we'd want to go back to the one-touch screen and see what we've got on here. We've got the door box here. We've got Mike Sandman as user speed dial here and Mike Smith as user speed dial there. So we'd go over to this. We'll make this a little bit bigger here. And you click the text tab here, and this is Mike Sandman, and the next one down here is Mike Smith. Oops. Extension 101. And we'll put this one office. And you'd go down the list and basically print out your own DESIs just by clicking. Actually, you have to use this print here. The one thing you absolutely have to do is make sure you don't have shrink oversized pages to paper size or fit to page. Otherwise, the DESIs will come out the wrong size. It's right there, the preview of what you're going to get. Click print, and that should go through on our printer. We should get that off the printer in a second. In the meantime, we'll go back to the NetSet utility. By the way, this is what they call this, the NetSet utility. And we'll go ahead and cancel that. And let's see, you can also print the attendant console labels. It's the same deal. APX messaging allows us to change our password and also change off-site notifications. So if we wanted it to go to a pager or cell phone or whatever, we can do it for all calls or urgent messages only. And it's very nice and convenient. It doesn't have to be done over the telephone. The customer can just type his information in right there and look at it whenever they want. Now let's go up to the ringer tones. This is really neat. There are so many open office areas now where people are in cubicles and you can hear all the phones ringing. If all the phones sound the same when they're ringing, it makes it difficult to get through the day, know whether to answer your phone or the person next to you. This lets you actually choose up to 9 different ringtones. Right now we've got extension 100 set for ringtone number 1, but we can change that. And it's also got samples. So if you have a sound card in your computer, a sound card is required to listen, you can actually listen to what the tones are. Here's what tone number 2 sounds like. And here's what 9 sounds like. Oh, that is a weird sound. Let's set it for 9. And oh, you can also have silent ring if you don't want your phone to ring at all. And we'll click apply. And then we'll call from the white phone, 100. That is a different sounding ring. You'll know it's your phone ringing. Boy, I think I'm going to change that back. That's too much for me. Now, just changing it isn't enough. We have to hit apply or it won't take. And then the last tab here is for the directory. If we had a big directory, you'd see all the people on the system here, and it gives you a search function also. And here are the DESIs hot off the printer. So this is customized for the particular extension. The system remembers what you've typed into all these boxes. So if you need to change it, you just type new stuff in. It remembers all the old stuff. And then you get out your handy-dandy scissors and you cut it out. And it's a nice square DESI, so it only takes a second. Okay, we've got that in there. Speaking of printing stuff, there's a few other things you can print, and this might be interesting to look at. Back with your personal speed dial numbers, there's a little printer icon down here. You can click print, and it'll actually print that. You'd then go, oops, I think actually you're supposed to click that print down there and print that out. Same thing for your system-wide speed dials, and then you can also do that for the quick reference guide. I think that's under user information. You can go into quick reference sheet, and if you don't want to just look at it on the screen, you can just go ahead and print that. And this is what it looks like after you print it. We've got the user speed dials, not very much in there yet, and a quick reference guide. One other neat thing it allows you to do is there's this little icon for the entire user's guide, and that's 88-page user's guide. Again, you can look through it on the screen, or you can print it out. Let's talk about using some of the features that we've seen how to program at this point. First thing we're going to do is look at how to use speed dial. We've already seen that we've got a couple of speed dial numbers programmed here. This is a speed dial, internal speed dial for Mike Smith's phone. That's internal. External speed dial is Mike Sandman's office. And just hitting that button automatically brings up a CO line and dials out on it. We also have in our personal speed dial, I believe 601 is programmed. So to use that, we just go off hook, feature code 601. And that dials out. That's our personal. Our personal speed dial numbers are 601 through 699. And system is 700 through 799. So we'll do 700, feature 700. And that's all there is to speed dial. The NBX100 has three different types of hunt groups. The first is a linear hunt group, which hunts from phone to phone, always in the same order that you programmed them into the hunt group originally. Second type is a circular hunt group that uses an extension list on the NBX100, which along with a cycle extensions option actually load balances the way calls are distributed to the phones. You can then add priorities to specific extensions in the list, which lets you create an overflow group of users who get calls only when the primary users are all busy. In addition, members of the hunt group can log in and log out so they won't receive calls while they're away from their desk. The NBX100 also has the ability to log a station out of the hunt group automatically if a call goes unanswered. The third type of hunt group is actually called a calling group, which rings all of the phones in the group at the same time. This would be useful for a sales or a service department where all of the phones would ring at the same time and the first person to get to their phone had the call. We've got a button programmed for the hunt group log in and log out. Right now we're logged in, so you see the light is on there. We can push that button and enter our password, which is 1234 pound, and we can see that we're now logged out of the group and the light is off. So now we won't be getting calls from that hunt group because I've gone to lunch or I've gone to sleep or whatever. Want to log back in? I got back from lunch, 1234 pound, and we're logged in. These various types of hunt groups allow you to tailor the operation of a system for a particular department, creating a mini call center. The NBX100 actually doesn't do much less than a full-blown ACD or automatic call distributor, which is usually pretty expensive. An ACD usually adds some features, though, that often integrate with computers, allowing screen pops for incoming callers. And ACDs usually provide management with very detailed reports on those calls also. Let's see how call pickup works. Let's transfer a call to 101. Okay, it's ringing over there. We've got a call pickup button programmed on here, which is the easiest way to use call pickup. And we know that's extension 101, pickup phone 101. And we've got the call. Another way to do that is to, we'll make another call again. And we'll transfer it to 101, transfer, is to use a code. And there's a code using a feature code. So we basically hit go off hook, hit feature 455. And now we have to put in the extension number, And we've got the call again. Obviously, having a button programmed makes a lot more sense than using the feature codes if you have the buttons available. Well, there's another type of pickup, and that's called group pickup. Let's say you have a group of salespeople or a group of service people, and they all can answer the same call. So they hear somebody's phone ringing, and they don't know which phone it is, but they know it's in their group. They can just dial a code. And we've already got code number 500 set up for the sales group, so let's try that. We'll make a call, and we'll transfer it to 101, and we don't have a button programmed for group pickup, so we're going to go off hook and hit feature code 456. It'll ask us the group number, group 500, and we got the call back. The system lets you put in account codes. Those are for call detail recording, or CDR. Basically, it's useful for tracking calls that are made that you're going to charge back to clients, or even to track calls made by employees who go from phone to phone and they don't always use their own phone. We have an account code button programmed here, and basically you can do this anytime during a call. So we'll make a call. Just push the account code button and enter the account code. 1234 pound. Okay, it's associated now with that call, 1234. When the customer gets the reports back, it'll say 1234 in the account code column, and they'll know what to do with it, either bill it to the employee, bill it to the customer. You can do the same thing using the feature code. We'll go ahead and make a call. And in this case, we're going to use feature 888.
Good evening.
And then we enter the account code.
At any time.
Pound to finish it.
The name directory, press
and the account code's entered. An account code can have up to 50 digits, which is pretty unwieldy. I don't know anybody that could enter actually that many digits, but it'll handle it. If you make a mistake on account codes, there's no error correction. It'll just show up under the wrong account code in the CDR report. See how we use the flash button. This is the flash button. It's programmed by default on that key without the LED. It's primarily used with Centrex or with lines feeding from a PBX into this PBX so that you can transfer calls in and out of the Centrex or in and out of the phone system. And to use it, we're just going to make a call. So we've made the call. We want to transfer this to somewhere else. We're going to hit the flash button. That would normally give us new dial tone. And then we dial the extension number where it's going to, or the Centrex extension, and the call would be gone. We just hang up. We can page from the phones by just going off hook and dialing. 620 is for external page. And I'll use the handset, hello, this is a page. And there is one nice thing about the external paging on this system. You can hear a little bit of a delay. That delay tends to stop feedback. So whereas a lot of systems, you need some type of actual feedback killer, which is basically records the page and then plays it back when the person hangs up or delays it for a few seconds so you don't hear the feedback. On this system, the built-in delay may actually prevent you from having to buy one of those systems. You probably heard that clunk. You don't want to do that. And the solution to that is either to hit the hook switch button like that when you're done paging, or hit the release button. That way it's a nice quiet sound and you're not making a big clunk through the whole office or the factory. Now, the system also has internal paging. 621 will page through the actual telephones, and then 622 pages for the internal and the external page. And on this phone here, we've programmed a page button for the external page. Hello, it works. Paging is usually used with parking orbits, which are places to park calls where anybody can retrieve it on the system. That's normally used with a PBX. With a key system, the calls are on hold. You just walk over to the nearest phone. You say, Joe, you have a call on line 3. You pick up line 3 and you've got the call. And a PBX, that line doesn't appear on all the phones, so you got to have something to do with it so that you can page somebody and tell them to pick up the call. One thing you can do is just let it ring at their extension, but on a system where you have voicemail, it's only going to ring 3 or 4 times before it goes to the person's voicemail, so that's not going to work. We're going to use parking orbits with this system, and there's basically 601 through 609 are the extensions that are reserved for parking orbits, and let's see how to use that. You know, the phone has a call park button that's by default right there, and we're going to show how to use that. We'll go ahead and have a call. This would really be an incoming call, but you could park an outbound call just the same. You'd hit call park, and it wants the park extension number, and again we have 601 through 609, so we'll put 601 there. The call is gone. It's actually out in outer space in a parking orbit of 601. Now we can go to the white phone and just go off hook and dial 601, and we've got the call. Keeping track of parking orbits can be a problem sometimes, primarily for the attendant. It's a lot of work for the attendant to see if they're parked 601, 602, 603, but let's see what happens. We've got 601 already busied out. We already put somebody on there. Dial another call. And we're going to call park it in 601. We basically get the signal all ports are busy, and it puts the call on hold. We have to go back into it, hit call park 602, and it's done. Now, if we want Joe to pick up 602, basically we just push the page button and say, Joe, pick up 602. And Joe goes over to the white phone and dials 602, and he has the call. You know, if Joe dialed 601 instead of 602, he'd pick up the wrong person and there'd be a lot of confusion, which sometimes happens with parking orbits. But in general, it's a good solution to paging and with the PBX. And we saw earlier how we could set up call forwarding in a user's NetSet utility. Keep in mind that if you change call forwarding to another extension or to an external number outside the system, the incoming caller won't be able to get your voicemail anymore unless someone does a direct transfer to voicemail after they receive your caller on their phone. Let's take a look at message waiting. We saw that there was a message button here earlier. The blue button has your own message button. But you can also program one of these keys with a light to be another extension's voicemail box message waiting indicator, or even a group box. In this case, it's extension 100. We can hit the button.
Extension 100.
And we can actually go ahead and put the password in and everything will work fine. That's really handy for, let's say, a service department where two or three people are responsible for getting all the calls dropped into a common mailbox. Whoever sees that light lit goes ahead and retrieves the messages, and whoever's at their desk can see when there's a message. This is the CLIR Next button, and this is really neat. I get a lot of requests from people on how they block their caller ID on their phone system so that nobody can see who they are or who's calling. CLIR in this case stands for Calling Line Identity Restriction, and this is a really neat NBX100 feature. You can never change the caller ID that other people see when you call them from a POTS line, other than to make it private by dialing star 67 or to have it permanently set as private by the phone company. The only time you can actually change what the caller sees is when you're calling from a primary rate ISDN line. That's how telemarketers make their calls show out of area on your caller ID box. You might occasionally see some goofy looking phone number like all zeros also. That's because on a PRI, the number that's sent to the phone company via SS7 or Signaling System 7, the nationwide data network used for setting up phone calls, is actually entered into the PBX by the installer. That's the secret of how telemarketers make your caller ID box show out of area. The NBX100 allows the administrator to program one of two types of CLIR buttons on the phone. The first blocks your real phone number on the next call only. The second blocks your real phone number on all calls after you activated it. This won't work on a POTS line from the NBX100 or from any other phone system, and it's only going to work with a T1 with a PRI at it. With many PBXs, you can program in a false number or even someone else's number in the PRI, but it's certainly not legal to use someone else's phone number. You normally see out of area or unknown. Since a PRI is going to cost you around $1,000 a month minimum, plus the cost of the NBX100 or another T1 capable PBX, this is not for everybody. Let's talk about the ATA, or Analog Terminal Adapter. As you can see here, we have the NBX cabinet with an Ethernet cable going to the ATA, which has a standard RJ11C on it, going out to a standard phone or a fax. The single-port 3COM NBX ATA can be plugged in anywhere on the network, just like a PC. It also has an internal hub to allow a PC workstation to be plugged into it also. The NBX also has a 4-port ATA card that plugs right into the chassis and gives you 4 RJ11 jacks. Let's take a look at the attendant console. A DSS works with a standard multi-button phone to create an attendant console. Power users can also use this DSS at their desk for one-button access to lots of speed dial numbers. The attendant console includes 50 buttons, or 100 using the shift key, for direct station selection, speed dial of pagers, cell phones, and home phone numbers, and for message waiting indication for individual and group mailboxes. The buttons are all programmed by the administrator on the DSS or attendant console. We'll take a look at how we can do that. There's basically a picture of the DSS there, and we have 5 rows, A, B, C, and D, to program. And then we have buttons 1 through 50, or we can select 51 through 100 as we do it. So we'll go back to 1 through 50, and we'll look at the first row, which is A. So we have 10 buttons there, and the next button right below it down there is actually the shift key button. And by default, all of these are defaulted to nothing. So when you put it in the system or you make a change, you have to change the buttons to whatever you need it to do. And this is the choice of the different things that you can make the buttons do. It could be a message waiting, it could be a CO line. You can put this would be nights, so system closed would be nights on, and system open would be nights off. There could be a lunch, and lunch, this would be a greeting that you'd have on the voicemail at, we're out to lunch, don't call us again at that time. And then standard telephone type features, speed dials, system, login to hunt groups, pickups, stuff like that. And basically you could go through each button and program it, A through E, and then F through J. And let's go ahead and cancel that. This is in the administrator's programming section. And we've basically programmed extension 100 as an attendant. And then there's 4 more buttons that we can program. These are the 4 buttons at the ends of the rows. And while there's still a transfer button on the phone, it's faster to have a transfer button on the DSS. So the attendant would hit a button, hit transfer, and it's gone. And then there's a direct transfer to voicemail button. This can be programmed for literally everything that you'd put on a telephone button. The park is going to be real handy. It's right there. And then there could be a hold button, but you can change that to whatever you need to change it to, so the operator doesn't have to go all the way over here to hit the hold button on her phone. Let's talk about setting these phones remotely from the system. You can take these phones, put them in a telemarketer's house or in the boss's house. It's very easy to do. It's just basically plug it into an IP connection through a router or a DSL line, something like that. But there are some slight limitations to operating over a low bandwidth connection. You can't page either internally or externally, but they can receive pages. You can't make conference calls, but they can participate in a conference call. And they can't play music on hold to callers, but they'll hear music on hold if put on hold by another phone on the system. Remote IP phones can be programmed to improve performance on a low bandwidth connection, like a 64K ISDN line or a single T1 channel. This is the device configuration screen that the administrator would use when setting up a telephone, and as you can see, it has a low bandwidth option. Just click right there and it sets all these other options, and it's perfect for operating over about a 64K line. Let's talk about making a Tappy connection to your phone. The NBX100 makes it very easy to allow you to dial from Windows applications. We're back at the NetSet utility that the user uses to program his own phone, and one of the choices on it under user information is NBX TSP. We go to that, and it allows the user to set up the Tappy service provider on his system by just clicking there and then clicking Apply. And we're going to run the program from the current location. And by the way, Tappy stands for Telephony Application Program Interface, but hardly anybody uses that nowadays. And it's done downloading right from the phone system into our computer here. We're going to go ahead and install it. It's setting it up. And we'll click next. Yes. It's going to put it where it wants to put it. And now we've got to put in the IP address of the phone system. And in this case, it is 192.1.190. Next. And our telephone extension is actually 100 that we want to use. Click next. Password is 1234. Next. That's that address. Okay. Finish. And we're back to the NetSat utility. We'll go ahead and minimize that. We're going to go to make sure that it got set up to settings, control panel, and look for telephony. And under telephony drivers, yep, it says NBX TAPI service provider. So that got put in okay. Next thing we're going to do is go to start programs. And under 3Com NBX, it puts in two programs automatically, the call reports or NBX CAS. Now, basically, the TAPI service provider is basically the link between your PC and the NBX system. The CAS is actually the complementary attendance software, which is basically a neat little dialer application, which makes it easy for the attendant to sort out by extension, look up extension number, or by first name, last name, or department, and dial right from this little application without having to look in a book. First thing we need to do is go to Options Update Directory, which populates the extension list off of the server. We're actually attached to the phone system, so it gets the information. And we have extension 100 Ed Evans, 101 Mike Smith. So if we want to dial 101, and we'll just click dial, and if you watch the lights on the phone just starts dialing as soon as we push the button. And it says it's dialing Mike Smith.
Hi, this is Mike Smith. I'm not in, but leave a message.
And we have this voicemail box. And the amazing thing about that integration is that it just took us a couple of minutes to download the software right off the system, and we don't need anything special. We don't need a special TAPI box that plugs into the phone that hooks up to the serial port on our computer. Everything is done through the Ethernet connection. Let's close the CAS application, and we'll take a look at doing the same thing in ACT. Now, a lot of times you're going to be using other software besides the CAS application. ACT is probably one of the most popular PIMs or personal information managers out there. A lot of people use it for sales contacts. It allows you to dial through a TAPI interface. And once you're in the computer and you've got TAPI working, this should work just as well with the NBX system. We've got ABC Company up here. We're going to just click dial. Al Smith's will call his mobile phone, and we'll click dial. And we want to watch the buttons on the phone. It's actually going off hook and dialing 327-9000, which is his cell phone number. And it went through. Now when we hang up, I push this button. ACT knows that we hung up, and it gives us a chance to type in here what the call was regarding. That is really easy. Let's talk about the PCX set. PCX set is 3Com's version of an electronic telephone that runs on your PC. You don't actually need a 3Com NBX telephone. It runs on your PC, and it uses a regular sound card type headset, and that's what you use to talk. The NBX 100 comes with a resource pack on a CD, and we're going to go ahead and open that. And the resource pack has NBX applications on it, product documentation, the same TAPI service provider that we saw before that's on the system, a neat little application called the 3Com Network Supervisor, and it gives you some third-party software also, which is Internet Explorer 5.0 or Adobe Acrobat Reader. We'll go back here to NBX Applications, which is what we want, and they have the CAS application here that we saw before, PCX set, which is what we're going to install, call reports, which actually got installed when we put the TAPI service provider in, NBX connections, which is a gateway to allow you to connect multiple NBX 100s together, a Palm dialer application, and the TAPI dialer application. Let's go with the NBX PCX set, and this will install the application on our computer, and next. It's going to put it where it wants to put it, in the 3Com NBX folder, and there it goes installing it. And it wants us to restart the computer, so I guess we need to do that now. And it's just about restarted. Okay, start programs, 3COM NBX. We're going to go to PCX set configuration wizard. And welcome to the wizard. Next, we are going to begin the AD PCM audio test. That's what we want. Well, that works. And this test ensures that your microphone is properly connected, configured your system. In addition, allows you to adjust the audio buffer size. So we'll start the microphone test. Test 1, 2, 3, 4. I hear myself. Okay. And next. This step specifies the information required to layer 2 communications. Auto discover the MAC address. We said that all network interface cards have MAC addresses. And here is the one that's in there. We're going to select that one. That's the network interface card in our computer here. If you have more than one adapter, we don't have that. And we'll click next, and it wants the IP address. So we'll put that in. We're actually not going to use IP on this, but we'll have it in there just in case we switch to it at some point in the future. .1.190. NBX system version, this is their version 3. And read network info automatically. Let's go ahead and test it. Okay, we've got the IP address, subnet mask, and default gateway. That's all right. Next. Before you can use the NBX PCX set software, you must add it to the NBX system. To do this, you must ensure that you have a license, and every system actually comes with the license on the KSU or in the chassis. Additional licenses you have to buy. And then that you've added the PCX set software to the system. If auto discover telephones is enabled in the NetSet utility, this will happen automatically. So we'll go launch the NetSet utility, and it's going to automatically discover what telephones are there. And this is what you actually have to do to program the system. Put in the username and password, and OK. And we'll go into programming the system a little bit later, but we'll just take a look at system configuration and system-wide. There's another number of tabs in here, but we're going to go to system settings, system-wide, and there's a little check mark for auto-discover telephones. So we're going to auto-discover the telephones, which means that when you plug a phone in, the system will get the MAC address of that telephone and automatically assign it the next available extension number, which is pretty neat. Okay, we're going to click apply to make sure that takes okay. And you want to probably uncheck that. We're going to go ahead and minimize the NetSet utility. We're back here on the configuration wizard. You probably want to uncheck auto discover phone so that you have a little control over how extension numbers are set up normally. So that's done. We're going to go to the next. Step determines the regional settings for the PCX set call progress tones. We're going to use the United States. Next. And we're done. And it says launch PCX set software when I click finish. So we'll click finish. And the PCX set came right up. This is it right here. All these buttons are active, but you can also use the keyboard to dial. So let's get dial tone here. And we can dial 101 using the mouse. Or we can hang up. And you can actually use the keyboard. Let's see, S takes it off hook, 101. And it's calling Mike Smith. Hello,
hello,
are you there?
Are you there?
Yes, I'm here. Okay, it works.
Okay, it works.
That was pretty easy. All of the buttons on the phone do everything that it does on a standard phone. So we've got the forward mail button. If we click the forward mail button, by the way, it saw that it automatically assigned this to extension 103. The date and time comes up. I'm just going to call from the black phone, 103. We can see up here that Ed Evans is calling. We've got the forward mail turned on.
The mailbox for extension 103.
Okay, that worked pretty well. We'll turn off forward mail. It has hands-free answer on the intercom, just like the regular phones do. So if I call 103, we can talk to the phone. Are you there?
Are you there?
Do you want to take
a call?
And as we can see here on the directory, we've got a new entry, new user, which was automatically added. We've got to go back and take off auto discovery in the administrator section, but that's where we would actually enter the new user's name. We can select it off the directory and actually call the extension, so you can see it's ringing as Ed Evans, and we can answer it. Hello,
hello
Ed, how are you doing? Oh, I'm doing fine.
Doing fine.
Okay, that worked good. Then we can take a look. The same directory is downloaded to the phone when we hooked up, so we have Donna Hunter, Mike Smith, and new user, and Ed Evans up there. These buttons all do the same thing. We can actually label all these buttons. We can right-click it. Type button text would be SA103. And that'll put it on the button there. This one is the feature button. Okay, so you can label the phone yourself. The message, in order to log into our voicemail for the first time, again, you just hit that button.
Please take a moment.
It's going to ask us to set up our voicemail. We'll go ahead and hang up on that. There's a number of options you get. By the way, the user has full help. So they can bring up the help on how to use their phone. Under tools, options, we can have a large style, a small style. We're going to just leave it on the large for now. A Windows style if you have a bad video card. Prevent machine from entering standby mode. You don't want your phone to go, the computer to go in standby. And then turn off, and then you can't receive a call when you have a call coming in. And we want it to pop up for incoming calls if we minimize it to the tray. The network settings were entered in for us automatically. When you first start it, you're probably going to have to play with the tone volume. This is the volume of the dial tone. And the audio buffer pool size you may have to play here, but somewhere between 5 and 10 should give you good audio even on a slow computer. And then there's a little free warning that we heard. It's a 1,000 cycle tone for half a second. And we heard that on an incoming call. Let's see, it'll restart now after you set the settings. There's also a hide window background, so we'll close this. We can actually have this phone sitting on our screen wherever we want, and we want to make a call. Oops, just make the call. And we'll go ahead and minimize it by right-clicking, exit, and we want to minimize to the system tray. And if we want to get the phone back, actually we'll go ahead and call it 103. It pops it up on the screen and we can see the display turns red while it's ringing. And we can go ahead and answer it. And that's all there is to it. This seems neat, but it's not that neat after you've used it for a couple of days. It's actually kind of a pain to have to use your computer as your telephone. You're doing a desktop publishing or you're printing a Word document or doing something, and all of a sudden the phone rings, it pops up, you lose your train of thought, you can't ignore it because it's there. There are only certain people that this works well for, certain jobs. Certainly a telemarketer or something like that, this might be neat because they don't need an actual instrument. They use the phone all day long, they keep making calls, keep receiving calls, and maybe they just deal with one other screen. But for the average person, this is fairly annoying. And while it's easy to sell because you see this and say, oh man, this is neat, this is great, but after a day it gets very old. So you should probably take advantage of the fact that the system comes with one license on it. If a customer is interested, let them try it for a day or two first. If they want to buy more licenses, then they can buy more licenses and put it on 100 phones, but they probably won't want to. Let's go back to the NBX resource pack disk, to the applications area, and go down to the NBX Tappy Dialer, which is a free application they give you to install that allows you to both dial outside the system and internal intercom numbers, just like the CAS that we saw earlier. And it's just about set up here. Next, it's going to put it where it wants. Three-com folder. As you can see, all of this stuff is incredibly easy to, we'll go ahead and launch Tappy Dialer, incredibly easy to install. And now it's asking us if we want to download new directory information from the NBX. We'll click yes, that'll basically import our whole directory in. In this case, we only have a couple of phones. And that's it. And it's sitting here in the tray, we're just going to click it. And we can see that it's just a nice little tiny application. We can dial any of the extension numbers that are already imported. For incoming calls, it'll list incoming calls. By the way, on incoming calls, you can get screen pops off of the ACT software that we saw earlier, or Goldmine, or other types of PIMS software. But sometimes it's a little more daunting to integrate incoming calls with screen pops than it is for integrating outbound calls using a TAPI interface. And that's because each individual piece of software has a little bit different kind of code that it uses on screen pops. So that, if you're installing that for a customer, I would at least give that a few hours to maybe a day to implement with whatever type of software they're using. So let's make an incoming call to 100, and it pops up on the screen. Hello, are you there? We can see that we're connected. When I hang up, it shows back to ready, and we can go ahead and hit close. And let's bring it back up here and see what other we have. We have the option of manually dialing. Probably the most useful part of this is the address book. This is the local directory where we can dial extensions within the system. We can dial Mike Smith, click release and close that, go back to the address book, and you can have your own personal directory. We'll click to personal directory. There's nothing in it now. Click new and put Mike, Smith, location at home, if I can type. And the phone number 916309807710 and add. And we're going to save it. And now we have Mike Smith in the directory. In our personal directory, we can go ahead and dial that. And it dialed. We'll go ahead and release that. When you're dealing with TAPI applications, you occasionally have to go in and set up under Settings, Control Panel, Telephony, the information for dialing. Like in this case, our area code is 630. To access an outside line for local calls, dial 9. For long distance calls, dial 9. Unified messaging. That's become a hot button to a lot of users. Unified messaging basically means that you're going to hear all of your voicemail messages in your email client, or you're going to be able to have your email messages read to you in your voicemail client. And it's more common to have the voicemails played back in the email client. And let's take a look and see how NBX does that. This is the Eudora mail program, and we're going to go into Tools, Options, and just set the program up. It's for Ed Evans. You can use Outlook also, ed@sandman.com. Mail server incoming is going to be the IP address, which is 192.168.190. Login name is the extension, which is extension 100. And we won't worry about outgoing. You can't really send outgoing from this anyway, from the NBX system. It's mainly for listening to your voicemail messages. Checking mail, it's going to go to that server. The login name is 100. We won't send messages on check. Incoming mail, and we're going to go with an IMAP server, and that's what this is actually called. And IMAP stands for Internet Message Access Protocol. We don't need a location prefix. We're going to download the full message, and I guess that's it. We're not going to worry about sending messages, so okay. Ask for our current password. That's the password for the mailbox. 1234. Okay, we have new mail. Let's click that. And basically we have two messages here. We'll get the first one. And we'll comes in as a WAV file, so there's actually no text. We'll just double click it and play it.
Hi, Ed. This is Ed McMahon. You've just won the sweepstakes. Give us a call. Thanks.
Well, that was a good message to get, but we'll go ahead and delete it. And here's the next message.
Hi, Ed. You're being transferred to Zanzibar this afternoon, but you will get a big pay raise with it. Thanks.
I don't know which is better, the sweepstakes or that. As you can see, it brings up Windows Media Player or whatever you use on your machine, but that's how you're going to get your voicemail messages into your email client and be able to listen to them. But that could be pretty handy. Let's take a look at the Call Reports application, which is the CDR program that's included with the system. As we saw, it was already put on our system when we put the TAPI interface in, NBX Call Reports. We'll go ahead and start that. It comes up with the installation information it needs, so the IP address is, again, 168.190. CDR login password is already in there. Retrieval, automatically retrieve every hour, or we could retrieve all the information. Actually, we'll go ahead and retrieve all the information just when we start the program, and that'll be retrieving all of the call data, all the calls made and received when we start this program. And we want to display fixed column widths, or you can do variable, and display all records or only the last 7 or however many days you put in here, and apply, okay. And we want to go ahead and retrieve from NBX system. And the retrieval complete. And it got a bunch of calls for us. Okay, so we see all the calls are made on this fake date. The call numbers in reverse order there. Original ID, so 750 would be the call from a trunk. Extension 100, 750 is a trunk. And this is the destination on incoming calls. Mike Smith or voicemail. And let's see, then you can get, this is just the raw data that you're looking at here. We can go to reports, we'll view standard reports, view the incoming calls, incoming today. So we've had 3 incoming calls. Those 3 of them were completed. There is no account code entered. Line card port is the originator. It ended up at Mike Smith's extension for this one. This call ended up on voicemail. And this call ended up at Mike Smith also. And the external party is the caller ID. And this one, this voicemail actually went to voicemail for station 102. And we'll close that and we can take a look at the incoming report, or the outgoing report. And we can see there's a few more calls, 5 calls there. We can see the originator is the extension number that made the call, what trunk it went out on, the time and the duration of the call, and the number dialed in each case. And we'll close the reports down. There's also custom reports you can get, which stuff like average call duration for a hunt group, call distribution hunt groups, calls per account code, calls per hour, line usage per hour, voicemail and notification usage. You can make your own reports. This doesn't come with a whole lot of reports, but you can make your own reports using Crystal Report Writer, which is a program you can get at a computer store that goes into a database and allows you to format the reports any way you want. The way most people use call accounting applications is they print out the reports once a month, and maybe if they do rebilling, they'll look for an account code, send whatever account that is a bill for 15 calls at $1 a piece or whatever. A lot of people use call accounting to prevent abuse. One of the best ways to prevent abuse is to run the report once a month and separate it by all the calls made by each extension. And then you give the person, let's say extension 103, the report of all the calls they've made, just leave it on their desk at night. You don't even have to talk to them about it. And when they come in the morning, they look at it and say, oh, geez, they know how many calls I'm making. I better be careful. Especially if you circle the longest calls or you circle the calls you know they're calling their girlfriend or their boyfriend, that really does help to stop abuse. One other real useful way to use this, especially since you can see the reports on the screen, is to have a supervisor of telemarketers or a little call center, as the day goes on, run the reports, look at it on the screen. They don't even have to print them out. Then they'll see how many calls Sally has made, how many calls Joe has made, how long they were, on how many incoming, how many outgoing. It really gives them an idea of the productivity of the call center person without having to spend big bucks on a call center application. Let's talk about system programming. We saw the user programming earlier, and the system programming is almost that easy. Again, it uses the browser metaphor, so we're just going to use our browser to go to the IP address we've already gone to, and we get the NBX NetSet administration utility. Instead of user this time, we're going to go to administrator, administrator, and the password, it may be anything on your system. And then you get the main menu, which is basically just a little window with a bunch of icons on it. APX voice messaging is for the voicemail. Device configuration sets up the line cards, the phones. Dial plan configures the dial plan or how the phone system basically works based on the digits you dial. Downloads are some accessories like the label maker and stuff that you can get. There's a fairly extensive help section that's online. Operation lets you back up the system or reboot the system. Reports gives you some basic reports on how the system's operating and how it's configured. System configuration lets you set up speed dials, the various system settings. The tab to it is a little utility that actually has all those icons listed on here, and then it shows each of the tabs under the icons. Unfortunately, they're very tiny and I can't see them, so I imagine you can't see them at home there. Then there's a TAPI configuration, just sets up the basics of TAPI. User configuration is basically the same thing that we saw with the user configuration for the user, except it lets the administrator go in and administer any phone that they need to. And then the administrator's guide and a full telephone guide is included, in addition to help under all of these sections. Let's take a look at the system configuration first and just kind of get an idea. We can't go through every single programming item in here, but we can give